You can't even put money aside to sponsor. I challenge you to do what you're supposed to do. Be the hands and feet yourself. Look at your hands right now. It's your responsibility. Just woke up. No, I haven't even brushed my hair yet, but I have a dream for you. Okay, so some of you have been called to get married and have kids, but I would venture to guess that most of you have not, and you're still waiting, and you're single like me, but I am single by choice. So I had a dream about singleness, and then I had another dream after that, just real quick dream about judgment before I woke up. All my single ladies, all my single ladies, all my single ladies. Okay, so I went to like this outdoors revival thing somewhere. I had been traveling, and when I arrived, I got flocked by all of these men, and they were like trying to make me think they were suitors, and you know, that they were obviously interested in me. But they weren't doing it in a very appropriate way. No, I was offended. And maybe that's just how I am anyways, whenever a guy wants to talk to me. I've had Christian men on Facebook wanting me to send them what they call singleness pictures. I don't know what that is, if that's a new thing. Guys, stop it. No, don't do that. Or if I had Christian men ask me if I wanted to be their girlfriend, if they could be my boyfriend. Don't do that, because we don't know each other. We just started talking on Facebook. There's not a lot of, when you're just messaging and posting verses on your profile page, on your newsfeed, no. And then the Bible study, you know, like the Bible study becomes like a date. Hey, you want to go out with me for a Bible study? And I just get offended by that. I choose to be single. I don't want to be with the man. So anyway, only Jesus Christ for me, you guys. Only Yeshua. So they were approaching me outside, and I was like laying on a blanket, you know, and they were like, it's almost like I could hear their thoughts. Like they were thinking how beautiful I am, you know, and if they could, like they were in competition with the other guys who were trying to get at me, you know? And I was like, oh my goodness, this is so annoying. And so I described to them, I let them in on my little secret, why I choose to be single. Everybody listen up. And then I'll tell you what happened, what they did, what their responses were. Wow. So I was going to tell them why I'm single, and they turned around and walked away. Yeah. Thank you very much for that. Thank you. Appreciate it. So they weren't really even suitable suitors to begin with, since these men didn't even want to listen to me, a woman. So the men who are trying to find a wife, they don't even respect females to begin with. They don't want to hear them out. They don't want to hear their story. And get this, one of them was a pastor. One of them was like the big guest speaker of the whole entire revival, right? And even he was like one of the first ones to turn around and walk away. Like, what she has to say isn't important. We're not going to listen to her at all. And that's a whole nother story. Like, I don't even want to get down on a rabbit trail right now. But for all of you misogynistic Christian believers out there who think that genitals can determine whether you preach, share the gospel or not, you got another thing coming. Because if you look up in history, dude, I learned this in seminary. It's all backed up in historical records. That in ancient Roman times, the females, okay, they weren't saved. They didn't know Jesus. They were extremely promiscuous for political purposes. They were trying to get their freedom as women, their freedom to be in the political realm by bragging about their independence and how many men they had been sleeping with. And they would dress very promiscuatively. Promiscuatively. There we go. I just woke up, guys. Give me a break. And we don't have that problem today, okay? We women are allowed to vote. And there has been way too much emphasis on genitals, and what kind of sexual organs you have, and whether or not you, I mean, why would you constrict the good news, right? Why would you put a leash on God and his work just because I'm a female? I don't dress promiscuatively to gain attention for political purposes like they did in ancient Rome. We've moved way past that, okay? Now we have voting rights, and today we're working on equal pay in the workforce. All my ladies, say hello. What's up? Historical context. Historical context. Historical context. is key. Because in the book of Romans, Paul, I don't care what you say, I don't care what you think, Paul was praising a female apostle. An apostle with a vagina. Okay, now that I got that little rabbit hole out of the way, thank you for your patience, because I know it's hard for you to listen since I'm a female. Yeah, all of those guys turned around and walked away, and one of them was the main prominent pastor of the whole entire Outdoors revival. I was like, dude, I wasn't even going to pick any of you anyways, especially now. So then I wanted to go like write a complaint. I wanted to complain about how they were treating people. Like, that's just like very rude. You're not even treating me like I'm a human, like I have a voice. Like, what if God had a message for you? He can speak through females. Yes, he can. And I hate that, you know, just because of my genitals, I'd have to be compared to a donkey. Like, I even have to be saying things like this right now. You know, like, if he can speak through a donkey, he can speak through a woman. Give me a break. Oh my goodness. You guys, no. So anyway, I go up to like this desk place, and there's people behind the desk, behind the window, and they wouldn't listen to me either. No, they wouldn't listen to me. And then Yeshua shows up, and we walk out of that whole establishment together, and hand in hand, he was holding my hand. And it was like we walked out of that whole realm, and we walked into a brand new scene, a brand new setting, a brand new realm. And there were judgment seats, and there were people testifying. There were people in the hot seat, like they were the ones being judged, and there was a whole panel of judges. I mean, it was serious, you know, like I was scared. Like I started to get scared, and I wasn't even one of the ones being judged. I mean, the whole thing was very solemn, and like you didn't want to accidentally even sneeze. You know what I mean? Like this was serious. People were being judged big time. And this came after my conversation with him last night. Just last night I was talking to him because I could hear a Sunday night worship service in a church around here in the neighborhood. And I started thinking about all these people that are just worshiping you and not doing anything that they were supposed to do, not doing anything that they're told to do. I mean, just recently, I've been like, oh my gosh, I had another dream, not last night, but the night before, that I got $17,000, like 17 grand. And I've been preaching about John 17 for almost 8 years now, you guys. John 17. What could we do if we joined forces and resources? Like, how much money would we all have together combined as an army of Messiah? And so last night, I started telling him, I was like, Lord, you got to calm me down because I'm starting to get mad hearing all these people worship you. And I know they're not doing what they're supposed to do. You know, like they're not saving money. They work worldly jobs and they can't even save $50, $100 a month to go sponsor a homeless person, for example, and get them an apartment, pay their first month's rent just so that a homeless person can relax and go get a job. Wow, they have the ability to take a shower every day. I was getting upset. Like, Lord, I can hear them worshiping you, but they're lazy and their eyes are, it's like they don't even want, all they want is to consume you. So with these people, and it's the same thing with singleness, the same thing. We have got more important things to do, you guys. Oh, than to sit around and think about our happiness in this life. To sit around and think about what I want in this life. To sit about and pray about a whole list of blessings. To want a spouse to be, you know, just like the world is dying. There's people out there on the streets. Because I can't do it. I can't do it. Lord, help me. When I was a homeless preacher in 2017, I saw terrible things. A man with AIDS crapping all over himself. With a walker, poop everywhere, every day. He was like this, and he was a young man, and it wouldn't matter, right, his age anyways, but we were surrounded by churches. There's a non-denominational church right there when I would sit down with him and talk with him, right in front of us, a Catholic church to our left, a Lutheran church to our right, and a Presbyterian church, Baptist church, right behind us. Where is everyone? Where is my family taking invading this planet with the kingdom of paradise? And all you want to do is think about yourself. And even if it was just yourself working, like I come across homeless preachers online and they're not even getting them off the streets. You know, people give their tithes to these organizations, but they're not the hands and feet of Jesus. So stop giving your tithe to these church organizations. They're not going out there into the streets. They're not getting these people out off the streets. They're not doing it. They send them to another organization that doesn't even have any beds available, while the money from the government is running out for their grants. You guys don't understand. We are the army. It's our responsibility. That's why I don't want a man. That's why I'm not looking for a husband. That's not why I am worried about, you know, consuming whatever happiness I can get out of this life, worshiping to feel good, worshiping to feel joy. Just at a church that doesn't ever do nothing, that doesn't even respect women in the first place. No. No. So there's judgment. Judgment, 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 judgment. Very serious, sinister judgment that you need to take seriously. Coming on to the churches. It's coming to the churches. It's coming to the churches. It's coming to the churches. Although they worship, they're not doing what they're supposed to do. I saw women on the streets beat up, afraid to go to sleep, thinking that they would die because of the concussion. I mean, busted out teeth, black and blue, like, in the city of churches, are you guys hearing what I'm saying? Do you understand the severity of the condition that the body of Christ is in right now? There's ministries that all they want to do is soak in the presence. We're going to do that for eternity, you guys, but you don't know when you're going to be called home. You could die in a car crash on the way to work today, or on the way home from work today, but you can't put aside $50 to $100 to sponsor someone? Really? Really? You'd rather just give it all to a church that ain't even going to do nothing anyway, that's going to be judged, and the judgment doesn't look very pretty right now. I saw it, and Yeshua was holding my hand. Whew. Whew. Now more than ever, the body of Christ needs to become the army, joining forces and resources, no matter what kind of genitals you have. It's not about your happiness anymore. We are the aliens, okay? We are the strangers passing through. This is not our home. If you call yourself a citizen of heaven, if you even think that you're seated in heavenly places right now, it is your responsibility to invade this planet with the kingdom of paradise. I'm telling you what, when I was a homeless preacher in 2017, I did not meet one homeless individual that did not believe in Jesus. They already know. They already know. That's their hope, because nobody else is caring, even in a city of churches surrounded by worshipers and sounds of worship and praise all around us. I was the only one sitting with them, getting to know them. It was only me. And I went to the church thrift stores after I got donations from people to go buy them clothes and necessities like toothpaste and toothbrushes and food and water and shoes and all kinds of things, like sleeping bags and tents. And the police would throw a lot of that stuff away if other homeless people didn't steal it, take it from them for drugs. Oh, and Matthew 25 tells us to take the stranger in. And you can't even put money aside to sponsor. I challenge you to do what you're supposed to do. Be the hands and feet yourself. Look at your hands right now. It's your responsibility. You are the church. We are the church. It's us. We are the army. Stop thinking in this worldly way that it's just organizations like 501c3 nonprofit tax exempt organizations that call themselves churches that don't go out there and do the work. Listen to me, even though I'm a female.